Good afternoon. Welcome to the Rotary Club of Fort Worth. It is Friday, October 6th, and I am so glad everyone's here today. We're going to start the program today with Darian George with the invocation, followed by the national anthem, played by Harriet Harrell. We finally have a pianist this week, so come on up, Darian.
All right, thank you. I was asked to step in by our infamous Pastor Charlie Johnson, so I'll try to keep it short today, no more than 5 minutes, so please bear with me. If we'll all bow our heads. Dear Lord, each year that I'm blessed to be on this earth, I become more aware of the fleeting time that we have with our children, our friends, and our loved ones, and it reminds me that we must stop and care for each other, check in on each other, and care for our community and the larger planet. We must focus on each other and how we can make a difference. Let us all remember to find our passion and use it for good. Lord, help us to use it for good, not divisiveness, not harm, and not ego. Allow us to hear each other, and thank you for this wonderful time that you give us every Friday with our fellow Rotarians. Let us cherish it today and every day. In your name we pray.
Thank you, Harriet. Y'all can be seated. Next up, Ed McLean. Come and talk. Give us our visiting guests.
Howdy, folks. That's my best imitation. Being State Fair season, that's my big Tex impression. Thanks, President Captain Kirk. Welcome to all of our guests. And I'm going to call your name out. And if you would please stand so everybody will know who you are. First off, we have Savannah Petronas. She's a guest of Maddie Compton. We have Rebecca Ingbretson, a guest of Cheryl Gillihan over here. Kenny Mosley, a guest of Harriet Harrell. Frank Mwangi, who's a guest of Randall Fluke. Yuri Portillo, who's a guest of a guest of Carol Del Real. And Emmanuel Avila, who's also a guest of Carol Del Real. Welcome to everybody, and here and in on Zoom, and hook 'em.
Thank you, Ed. Welcome, all of our guests. If you like what you see today, come on back. Feel free to hit up the person who brought you and come back and do that a couple times, and maybe consider joining our esteemed organization. We'd love to have you. So next up is a four-way test. For all of our visitors, a four-way test is something that every Rotarian uses kind of as a guidepost for everything we say, think, or do. So if you'll repeat along with me, number one, is it the truth? Number two, is it fair to all concerned? Number three, will it build goodwill and better friendships? And number four, will it be beneficial to all concerned? Thank you. Now throwing that out the window for a few minutes, Ann Sheets, come on up here and deliver the newscast for us.
Thank you. What a week this has been. So much news. I asked Captain Kirk what he would recommend I mention first, and he said global warming. warning. Yes. And I thought, well, that's weird. But then I realized it's an icebreaker. One of Donald Trump's trials started this week and doesn't look good for the former president. The judge has already determined that he's guilty of fraud, although Mr. Trump claims it's just another witch hunt. Well, a representative of the Association of Witches said they are not happy with what they call the continued disparagement of their craft and Trump's constant complaint of witch hunts. In fact, they're planning a nationwide protest at the end of this month. They said, just wait. On the 31st, we'll be out there in force on everyone's front porch protesting. Rough crowd. And the unemployment rate has gone up, at least in the U.S. House of Representatives. Kevin McCarthy was fired on Tuesday. Did you see the vote conducted by the clerk of the House? I really think she was biased. Every time someone voted to get rid of McCarthy, she said, yay. The House is set to elect a new speaker next week, and it appears they may be turning to another Kevin who has a reputation for protecting the House. In the meantime, President Biden has called for the legalization of marijuana. To debate the issue, Congress will be holding a joint session. Thank you. Thank you. And McDonald's has added a new presidential value meal. You order everything you want, and the person who follows you has to pay for it. Speaking of presidential politics, people are still talking about the last Republican debate. I think that group needed a refresher lesson on the four-way test, because when the topics of debate include Donald Duck and curtains, it's just not beneficial for anyone and didn't build goodwill and better friendships. Big business news today. It looks like FedEx and UPS may be merging, with a massive increase in package deliveries and delays expected during the holiday season. I'm not sure what to expect of customer service now. The new company is going to be called FedUp. And congratulations to the Texas Rangers, who made it to the Major League playoffs. They won their first two games. At the last minute, they added a ghost to the roster. It seems they needed a little extra team spirit. Can't beat it. It's working. And speaking of ghosts, it's almost Halloween. You know, it's sad. Halloween used to be the scariest night of the year, but not anymore. That distinction now belongs to election night. Tough crowd. The weather forecast calls for cooler temperatures and sunny skies. And since it's cooled off, I decided it might be a good idea to start an exercise program. But then I decided not to. I'm actually part of the fitness protection program. Finally, TCU had a rough weekend, but hopefully they'll bounce back against Iowa State on Saturday. And congratulations to all of you University of Texas fans. The Longhorns are number 3 and poised to go far this year. The Red River rivalry is this weekend as the Longhorns take on OU. Enjoy the football games and have a great weekend.
Thank you, Ann, as always, a great, great newscast. All right, to the stage, Nathan Schneiderman, where are you at? Come on up here, give us an announcement, followed by Ryan Jodich with another announcement.
Thanks, President Trevor. There's a little squeaky spot here. So we got a little Farlow tag team here. So I was asked, I wasn't asked, I was just assumed that I was going to talk about the R&B mixer because everybody else has gone fishing. So I'm just holding down the fort. Here we go. So we're going to be having, for the Rotary Minority Business Awards, we're going to be kicking off. The event is going to be on April 19th next year, as always. We've got the mayor confirmed for that as well, so it's going to be great. But we're going to be having a kickoff event. It's going to be Wednesday, October 18th. It's going to be at Game Theory. So Erica, she won our Minority Business Awards last year, and she is going to be opening up her restaurant, Game Theory, in South Main to host a mixer for us. So we're going to have the Black Chamber there, we're going to have the Hispanic Chamber, and we're going to have the Fort Worth Rotary Club there, and we're going to be talking about the upcoming year sponsorships. Nominations are going to be open. Nominations should actually be open now. So I'm not sure. There's a QR code. What does anyone know? What QR code is this? Hold on.
I made like three.
It allows you to register to get an RSVP.
That's an RSVP? Okay, good. Okay. So that's an RSVP to the event for Game Theory. So, but if you attend that, then we're going to talk about everything that's coming up, sponsorship opportunities, all the exciting things that are going to be part of the Minority Business Awards this year. All right. And I think that's it. Let me just check. Richard sent me an email last night. It was after a couple of whiskey, but let me just make sure. We'll be seeking Rotarian advocates. This is important, to engage with nominees, applicants throughout the process. So the advocates is an extremely important part of the Minority Business Awards. What that is you're basically volunteering to be the face and representing our club for the nominees. So you call them up and you say, hey, usually get a little bit of dinner, maybe some coffee, talk about our club, talk about the Minority Business Awards, help them along the process as far as getting their application done. That's what brings people into our club. You see our club and how it's, over the past few years, it's become a little bit more representative of our community at large. The reason is because of the advocacy, and that's a very important job. So if anybody wants to talk to me about that, or Richard, or President Driver, that would be very appreciated. Anyway, I think that's all I got. Thank you.
Come on up, Ryan. I'm going to add a little bit to what Nathan said. So last fall, the club sent me to San Jose, California for the Large Club Conference. And at that conference, I got to interact with president-elects from around the country of the various larger, the big Rotary clubs. And we had a DEI session there. And they talked about what can your club do for diversity and inclusion. And I will tell you, hearing all the others, it was like, are you kidding me? That's what you do? You have Taco Day for Mexican Independence or something? I mean, truly, it was like, ew. But when I mentioned our Rotary Minority Business Awards, which are not for Rotarians, mind you, it's for minority businesses in our community to participate and get exposed to Rotary, and we help them get a foothold and their name out in the community. What we do here has been adopted by numerous clubs across the country. Carlo and Chris Jordan and crew went down to the Rotary International Convention in Houston last year and promoted it. I, at just mentioning it at the Large Club Conference, had multiple clubs hit me afterwards. Do you have the roadmap for this? Do you have instructions? And through that, I was able to take what these guys have put together and pass it to other Rotary clubs. So something that we've grown right here in our club is having an impact nationwide, to include Rotary One, the original club in Chicago, Illinois. That club reached out to me and said, we want to do something similar. Can you send us the roadmap? So thank you to Carlo and Chris Jordan and everyone, Adrian Galvan, all the guys who started this thing. Second quick announcement. You mentioned the fishing trip. So several of our members are out of state right now. I got a text from Tran Trong this morning asking me to send well wishes from them to you. So if you guys are watching up there, hope y'all are having a great time fishing. They said the weather was like 41 degrees this morning, so just lovely time. We're looking forward to having you guys back next week. Thank you.
Nathan, I think the term you were searching for was you were voluntold. Voluntold. And if you're a Rotarian past about a month, you will become very familiar with that term. I'm Ryan Jodashore, a Rotary International Foundation Chair. October 24th is World Polio Day. Rotary International's number one goal worldwide is polio eradication. Now, we know as Fort Worth Rotarians that when we put in our time, treasure, and talent into something, good things happen. The same applies to Rotary International. We are this close to stopping polio across the world. And next week, we'll be illustrating exactly how truly, with a map and some graphics, how close this close really means. Since 1985, and because of Rotary International's laser-like focus, more than 4 million children who may have been polio victims are walking and playing normally. I have a bigger number for you. More than 2 billion children have received polio vaccines. Thank you to Rotary International. Now that is because of Rotarians just like you who have traveled across the world, partnered with local clubs around the world, and administered polio vaccines, sometimes even in drops. They're given very simply and the kids don't cry that way and they kind of go on their way. Maybe someday people in this room can take one of these trips. I have not been. Has anybody been on a administering trip? It is magical. I've talked to people who have went. They said, oh, we got one. Oh, Mac has been, okay. And they have been truly life-changing. Mac, was it life-changing?
Yeah, amazing. We went to Mexico, and we were on a hilltop in the middle of nowhere, started ringing a bell, and over 3 days, people just came out of the forest, and we got their kids vaccinated. Amazing.
That's great. So how can we get involved right now? Well, by donating to Rotary International. So if you go to rotary.org, there's a big blue button on the upper right side of the website that says donate. Click that and you'll begin walking you through the steps. Now remember, I want to repeat this every time I'm up here. We're not asking you to not give up any of your support for our local foundations. We're asking for an and, not an or. And once again, please remember when you donate to Rotary International, 42.5% to 45% of the funds come right back to Texas, okay, in 3 years. So help be a part of the people in the organization that have stopped polio in 4 million children and have administered 2 billion polio vaccines. I ask you to please donate today. It's important to President Captain Kirk, it's important to the well-being of the world, and that is truly not hyperbole. If there's any questions or you'd like to get involved on the committee, please feel free to reach out. We have 3 new members on the committee since last time I spoke, so there's 4 of us now. We're excited. We're going to have our next meeting right here in this room before next week's actual Rotary meeting. So if you want to get involved, stop by a little bit early, look for me, and we'll get you signed up. Thank you.
Thank you, Ryan. And yes, that is very near and dear to me. I truly believe in the mission that we are doing through Rotary in stopping polio. It's just amazing. So we're here for the main event. Next up, Rabbi Ralph Mecklenburger, chairman of the day. Please come on up and tell us about our guest.
Thank you, Captain Kirk. When I was a young rabbi, which I'm definitely not anymore, it was unthinkable that Jews with over 6 million victims tortured and more than that tortured and killed during the Holocaust or Gentiles who fought in World War II and were affected by it, was it unthinkable that anyone would ever forget the Shoah, as we call it in Hebrew, the Holocaust. When we observed Holocaust Memorial Day, the crowd always included a bunch of people with tattoos on their wrists from concentration camps. We needed to remember, to preserve at least the memories of the victims, and to minister to the spiritual needs of the survivors. Moreover, for civilized people everywhere, the words of American philosopher George Santayana still haunt us. Those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. The Holocaust, pardon me, was the largest genocidal mass murder that we know of, but it was neither the first, nor since then has it been the last. The survivors of something that happened some 80 years ago are fast disappearing. And many had sworn to themselves that they would not traumatize their children or their grandchildren by telling their stories. And that is where people like Anna Eisen and her son Aaron, who's with her as well, come in. She's a social worker and was a therapist who lives in nearby Westlake, and a founder of the synagogue in Colleyville, speaking of, yes, that synagogue, speaking of remembering and never forgetting. Anna convinced her Holocaust survivor father that he had to tell his story and helped him turn it into a book back in 2002. Before then and since then, years and years of studying and speaking on Holocaust history, she wrote another book recently together with her son, whom we're happy to have with us, Aaron, and it is called Pillar of Salt, A Daughter's Life in the Shadow of the Holocaust. The world will only remember if subsequent generations, that's all of us, not just them, keep the memory and the stories alive. I can tell you from personal experience that she is a charming woman, a fine writer, and an excellent speaker. I've heard her more than once. So I'm honored to present the daughter of George Salton, Anna Salton Eisen.
First things first, I have to make sure I know how to work the clicker. I passed. So thank you so much for having me. I want to start by sharing a sentiment that my father shared with me, that back during those long, terrible years of suffering and misery and hardship, he and his fellow prisoners made each other a promise. If any of them would survive, they would go forth and tell and speak of what they had witnessed and endured. My father had a dream that one day there might be a miracle, where good people, without fear in their hearts, would gather together to learn and remember and care. And by being here today and allowing me to share that story, each of you is now a part of that miracle, and I thank you. So these were my parents, Ruth and George Salton. They were both Holocaust survivors that met in the United States. They changed their names, they buried the past, and they started a new life. For most of my childhood, I know nothing about the Holocaust. I mean, it was concerning my father. We had no family relatives, no photographs. And if I would ask my father about his upbringing or his past, he would look very upset and say, well, they died in the war. And as a child, I learned not to bring up these topics, to see the look of anguish across his face, so I kept quiet. When I was about 8 years old, I remember going into the den in our house looking for a deck of playing cards, and I reached my hand deep into a side table drawer and felt two stiff pieces of paper, and I pulled them out. They were watercolor paintings. This here was the first. not something I'd ever seen in any textbook or school book or storybook. And I couldn't believe and wondered why this was in our house and not quite hidden. I could tell that there were soldiers and scenes of violence, and I carefully pulled it back, pushed it back, and pulled out the other, which was equally frightening. Here in vibrant colors was a young man kneeling before a pit filled with bloody bodies. A soldier held a gun to his head. They were both signed by an L. Zaltzman, which was a name I didn't know. But I knew enough that I couldn't bring this up to my parents, so I quietly put them back, shut the drawer, and didn't bring this up for nearly 30 years. Also in my house, I discovered this photo hidden in a drawer in my father's bedroom. I wondered, were these my grandparents? Could this be my family? I didn't know, but I knew again that I couldn't ask. I kept the secrets in our house, and I lived growing up feeling with that sense of sorrow. All I knew was that I was named Anna after my grandmother, who had died in a gas chamber in this event called the Holocaust. But eventually, as I got older, I moved to Dallas area, and I saw that there was a Holocaust museum, and there I got my education. I became a guide, a docent, eventually doing the interviews for the Steven Spielberg Foundation, and it gave me the knowledge and courage, and I felt compelled to confront my father. Of course, at first, he was very taken aback, and he said to me, "I am Adam. Everyone and everything is gone, and it all starts over with me." But I said to him, "You're not Adam, and this is also my history." And so I asked him to go back with me to Poland with my mother, with them as our guides, and teach me and tell me about our Jewish history, our family history, and about what they had been through. And they agreed. I finally learned that my mother, Ruth Wolfberg, her real name was Sima Nicholsberg, and she was born in a small town in eastern Poland. In the summer of 1939, after finishing high school, she went to visit a favorite aunt who was living here in Warsaw, a bustling, vibrant city with 1.3 million people. Approximately 30% of them were Jewish. And she was there in September of 1939 when the Nazis invaded and bombed Warsaw. She told me how her and her aunt that she was staying with would go down into the shelters, into the basements, and wait all day until the bombs stopped. Going back up into the streets, which we visited here, rebuilt in that picture, I could understand finally what she had witnessed and endured herself. Her family was back in eastern Poland, and she had lost contact with them, so she was afraid to go. But at one point, the Nazis created the Warsaw Ghetto there. The Jews were forced to build this 10-foot wall that enclosed them in an area that was overcrowded, filled with danger, hunger, deprivation, typhus. And they finally decided, her aunt, that she needed to go and look for her family. At this point, Jews could no longer ride on the trains. The Nuremberg Laws created in Germany had come into Poland. Jews couldn't travel on trains or buses. They couldn't have weapons or radios or typewriters or pets. There were so many restrictions as they lost their freedom. So my mother fled east in search of her family. On my trip back, we visited Warsaw and other places like here in Krakow, where we saw empty and desecrated synagogues and cemeteries. In this one here, I took a picture with my parents in it, and in the front they had these painted cutouts of what Jews used to look like in prayer. I felt that I was at some kind of dinosaur exhibit at a museum. In the markets, this is what I found on the shelves: wooden figurines of stereotypical Jews holding prayer books and musical instruments, and yes, even some holding bags of money and coins. The old stereotypes of Jews, the anti-Semitic ideas and images are not just alive, they're for sale. With my parents, we continued on, and we returned here to my father's town. On the top left, he showed me the elementary school where he had gone up until completing the fifth grade, until the time where the Nazis said Jewish children could no longer go to school. We walked the streets and visited the homes of some of his friends, people like the Tuchmans and the Goldmans, who had all disappeared. And then even though he said there was no way, he was too afraid, we found our way back into his house, pictured here on the right, where the new owners talked, you know, boastfully about how they had turned the house and the rooms into a boarding house, where people had come in and eaten off his dishes and slept in their beds. I finally learned who my father was. My father was Lucian Zaltzman. He was the artist who painted those watercolor paintings. He had spent 3 years in 10 concentration camps in Germany, Poland, and France, starting at the age of 14. And at the age of 17, when he was liberated, that is when he painted those paintings. Later in life, he returned to drawing as he began to tell his story. Here you can see how he remembered his small town of Tichen before the war, a town that was safe and friendly, where Jewish and non-Jewish children played together in the streets, where people went to synagogue to pray, where life was good and safe. But then in September of 1939, after the invasion, as my father draws here, the first thing that happened was that all the community leaders, including my grandfather, who was attorney, were arrested by the Gestapo in order that they should not form any kind of resistance. Life was difficult and cruel and dangerous, but after 2 years, there was an order put up that all the Jews in the town would have to gather together, carrying only what they could take from their homes. At this point, they had almost nothing, and walk about 6 miles to the nearby town of Rzeszów, where the Germans had created a ghetto. This is an original photograph of the people from my father's town walking to the Rzeszów ghetto. Maybe among them are my grandparents. In the ghetto, life was difficult and dangerous. And after a short time, it was decreed that the Jews there, 23,000 of them in a small 2-mile area, would be put on trains and sent east to abandoned farms where there would be food and more room. The Germans had taken over an airplane factory there. Daimler-Benz was operating it, and they did not have enough Polish workers. So they agreed to allow the Daimler-Benz factory supervisors to keep approximately 500 young Jewish men behind to work as slave laborers. Among them was my father and his older brother. Thus began my father's journey from Rzeszów, because the Germans, the Nazis, Germanized all the names of towns, so Rzeszów became Rzeszów, as one of the 465 Daimler-Benz Jews. My grandparents, all my other relatives, all the people from the ghetto were put on the trains and sent away. My father worked here initially sweeping the streets. His brother, who was with him, was in a different part of the camp. My father would go every day back to the ghetto until a barracks was built, and this became the first concentration camp my father would be in. At one point, all the young men in my uncle's group were deported, and my father was alone. But after a short while, a Polish worker came to him with a note from his brother saying, "Dear brother, I have escaped. I don't know that I will be able to keep contacting you, but after the war, we shall try and meet by contacting the one relative who escaped and came to America." After a while, the SS came and said no more Jews are allowed at the factory. So the 465 were put on a train, on a boxcar, and sent away. The next camp they went to was Płaszów, the camp made famous in Schindler's List. This camp was built on the grounds of two abandoned Jewish cemeteries. And here my father and the others had to use shovels or sometimes their own bare hands to give up the graves. After a while, they were put on the train and sent nearby to Krakow, to a place called Wieliczka, famous for the salt mines. Here my father labored deep in the tunnels. After another short while, they were again put on the trains, but this time they would leave Poland and cross into Germany. The next camp my father went to was Flossenbürg, seen here in an original photo, that was built on the grounds of a stone quarry. Here my father and the other laborers had to try and survive with little food, with little clothing, doing this difficult work, and anyone who was too weak or who stumbled could be shot by the Nazis. In this photo, as in much of the artwork, my father began to incorporate his prisoner numbers. The prisoner on the far left, bent over with that shovel or hoe, has the number 16,019. This was my father's prisoner number in the Flossenbürg camp. From Flossenbürg, they were sent again in boxcars across the border again to France. Through a town in Colmar, they arrived in a place called Orbis. Here, the French had built and abandoned a railway tunnel before its completion, and the Germans and Daimler-Benz came in and moved all the factory equipment into the tunnel seen here. If you visit today, you will see painted on the walls, here worked 462 Polish Jews, because by arrival, three had died on the trains. Again, my father, as the Allies approached and the factory was being bombed, were put onto another boxcar, here again in one of my father's other drawings, all held at the U.S. Holocaust Museum. And again in Germany, they went to another camp. This one was called Sachsenhausen. Here my father recalls and draws the picture of French resistance prisoners, not Jews, that were forced to march in endless circles all day with a T that stands for Tod, which means death in Germany. At the end of each day, one would be selected to be hung. My father watched this, knowing that there was nothing he could do but watch and remember and vow one day to bear witness to this. From Sachsenhausen, they were sent to another camp where there was a munitions factory called Wattenstadt. Here he learned that their group, as they were dwindling, would be separated, some going to Bremen and some going to Braunschweig. There was another prisoner there named Joseph Singer. He pleaded with my father to change places. He wanted to go with the other group to stay with his cousins and the people he knew. My father didn't know what was the right thing to do, but he agreed to go ahead and switch places. Joseph Singer went, as my father, Lucian Zaltzman, to Bremen. Of the 225 prisoners who went, only one survived, and it was not Joseph Singer. My father was in Braunschweig now, laboring again. From there, that group, which was now down to 225, were sent to Ravensbrück. Ravensbrück was one of the only concentration camps, the largest and major one for women, but it had a small sub-camp for men. Here my father recalls seeing the women prisoners in their thin, worn, shabby striped dresses beyond the barbed wire. At this point, there was no work, the factory equipment had been destroyed, and at this point they were concerned that they would be of no use to the Germans and not kept alive. One more time, they were put on the trains and sent to Veblen in northern Germany, a subcamp of Neuengamme. Veblen was a concentration camp that was only open 10 weeks. When my father and the remaining group arrived, there were many prisoners there who were not Jewish from all different countries, and the camp was not yet finished. Most of the barracks had no doors, no windows, and as you can see here, even the bunks were just somehow parts of twigs or trees with no place to sleep, and they slept instead in the mud and straw on the floor. Conditions were terrible and people were dying every day. On the night of May 1st, again, they were put on the trains, but the trains didn't move. They sat all night. In the morning, on the morning of May 2nd, the Germans ordered them out of the train, back into the camp. And my father and the others ran back into the camp, and the guards in the towers were shooting at them. My father tried to press himself down into the dirt, and soon it was quiet. He looked around and saw that the guard towers were empty and the Germans were gone. He heard a sound that sounded like the muffled beating of a drum, but he realized what it was. It was the prisoners, the men running in the wooden shoes that they had been given. And my father somehow crawled his way up around past the latrine where the bodies were piled up and came across a miraculous sight. American soldiers. A small deployment of 7 or 8 from the 504th of the 82nd Airborne had come across the camp and discovered it and liberated them quite unexpectedly. And this is an original picture taken that day. My father and the others were free. Here in a photograph taken by the photographer on that day, May 2nd, is my father, second from the right. He would spend 2 years in displaced person camps there in Germany, run by the British and the Americans. He kept sending letters with American soldiers to New York looking for his one uncle and aunt who had gotten out, even though he didn't have their address. And finally, a soldier got through to his relatives, and this is the original telegram that my father received saying that you will come to us, to America. Both of my parents came separately. These are the original photos of them on the ships, my mother on the General Moore and my father on the USS Marine Flasher. Here's a little drawing that my father kept that I found after his death since 1947, just on a small scrap of paper. He had drawn this little image to remember that special day. Once in the United States, my father was drafted. He served in the U.S. Army. He met and married my mother, who was a Holocaust survivor. And using the GI Bill, he went from fifth grade to college, where he earned a bachelor's in physics, a master's in engineering, and served as the director of communications in the Pentagon. After our trip, we wrote the original version of the 23rd Psalm. He chose the title because he felt like David, who had written that prayer, must have understood what my father had gone through, which now just came out in a 20th anniversary edition, a finalist for the National Jewish Book Award with a new foreword by Michael Barenbaum, who curated the U.S. Holocaust Museum. When the book was out, we started to experience all these incredible connections. At the first publisher, University of Wisconsin Press, we wanted to include that photo of my father being liberated. So we had to send the book that it was in, this one here called The Devils in Baggy Pants, which is what the Germans called the parachutists, and which the unit proudly kept as their name. The permissions editor there discovered something. Her father, seen here in the middle, was one of the seven soldiers who liberated my father. We flew there to have a reunion with CNN, and my father was shocked to find that one of the sons had the Nazi flag that his father had cut down from the camp on the day my father was liberated. In Colleyville, Texas, I heard about this guy. I don't know if anyone's heard of him, James McGillis, called Maggie. He was the most decorated veteran of the 82nd Airborne in World War II. He had written about in his book, Liberating the Veblen Camp. He was one of the seven or eight soldiers who liberated my father. I introduced them and they became friends. Here in the middle, you can see where they traveled together at the guest of the German government back to the Veblen Camp to lay a wreath where they had met across the barbed wire. And here's a photo of me when I last saw Maggie when he was 101. He died when he was 103, but because of COVID, his funeral was delayed. But last September, I traveled to Arlington National Cemetery, as I know my father would have done himself if he was alive, to pay honor and last respects to this great American hero. I heard about the Arlson Nazi Archives, the largest repository of German Nazi documents, and I started searching them, looking for my father. Knowing finally his real name and his date of birth, I found his name on a list of prisoners from Ravensbrück. Here, an original document from the Flossenbürg concentration camp with my father's number 16,019. And in such beautiful, almost calligraphy handwriting, the original list from the camp in France, my father, number 33,339. I found post-war cards that listed all 10 camps, along with most of my father's prisoners' number. At the first camp, he had a very low number, 222, because he was one of only 465. Going through the archives, I made incredible discoveries. Here, the original bread list from the Veblen concentration camp on the day my father was liberated. Across the top, the end of April, May 1st, but the date of May 2nd, the column is completely blank. On that day, there was no bread. There was freedom. I also learned through my research more about what happened on that night when they boarded the train that didn't leave on May 1st. All the prisoners from the Veblen camp, from Neuengamme, and all the subcamps were headed to Lübeck Bay. There, they were put on ships, two of which were shot down mistakenly by the British, thinking they were full of Nazis, and 6,000 prisoners drowned, were burned to death, or shot swimming to shore. My father was supposed to be among them. After my father died and I brought my mother to live with me, I discovered among his belongings his post-war concentration camp pass, a small diary and calendar, and a whole collection of these black and white photos, much like what middle schoolers or high schools might exchange after their yearbook picture. But on the back of them, I found the names written in my father's handwriting and signed by them of the people whose homes I had visited, of the people he had talked about and we had written about in his book. All of a sudden, they became real people to me with faces and stories. So I went back to the archives to look again. Incredibly, I found this list that says 465 Hoffling prisoners, Jews from Reichshof, my father's third from the bottom. I went back to the Ravensbrück list and found the prisoners so I could identify their hometown and their date of birth, and continued to search using Ancestry, the U.S. Holocaust Museum, Yad Vashem, the Arlson Archives. I discovered more and more documents. Each prisoner had this yellow card from Flossenbürg. This was their possession list. Of course, they were all blank because no one had any possessions, but also these post-war cards, like this one, identifying that this Moses Tuchman, whose home I had visited, had been with my father in 10 camps, liberated together, and was going to New York. For each of the prisoners, I looked for documents and clues. I went in search of seven of them that had been with my father from the ghetto, from the 10 concentration camps, and liberated together. And I found them all. We had a reunion here, people zooming in from Sweden, where the Red Cross took sick prisoners after the war, from Israel, from New Jersey, from Texas, from New York. None of them knew their father's stories. They knew that they had been in some kind of camp, but many of them, unfortunately, had died as young fathers, maybe from the conditions in the salt mines or the stone quarries or the DDT that they were sprayed with to get rid of the constant infection of lice. But I don't think ever that our fathers would have dreamt that one day we would find each other and form a bond of friendship in honor of the bond that they had kept as friends to keep each other alive. And so with my son, I wrote Pillar of Salt, the second book that tells the story, and now we have a film coming out in a few months based on both. On the top is one of my favorite photos. It's my son and my father walking in step at the Majdanek concentration camp. I took this photo in their moment of privacy because I knew and I felt in my heart that they were having that conversation that I couldn't have when I was his age. Who was my father? I look at the watercolor painting and I look at my father's photograph and I can't help but feel that he was trying to tell his story even back then, even right after liberation. Looking at the picture close up in the back, I see a young man that my father painted wearing a yellow star with the number 222, my father's number. And in the small diary that I discovered, not just the list of camps and the same star and number, but under his own name, my father wrote the name of Joseph Singer so that he would never forget this other person who had died in his place. I also learned about my grandmother. She was more than someone that died in a gas chamber. Here's a letter that she sent to the relative in New York with a heavy mark of the censors by the Nazis. She was a woman who sold and traded everything she had just for some potatoes to feed her family. She was a woman who went to Rzeszów when my grandfather was held in the Gestapo prison and pleaded and found good and courageous Christians, friends, lawyers, and judges who somehow risked their lives to get my grandfather released. And she was also the mother that on the day when they separated, when she had to go on those boxcars that didn't go to abandoned farms, but went only a short distance to Belzec, an extermination killing center where more than 600,000 Jews were killed in 11 months, gassed on the same day they arrived. That she convinced my father, who did not want to stay behind, because she thought maybe that that would give him a way to live. Here is my father remembers in a sketch with his feet almost off the ground. And in closing, I want to share this special discovery that I made looking through the Arlson Nazi archives. In this record post-war of all the prisoners in this concentration camp, put together by an American soldier in the Third Army, he somehow interjected his own feelings into this official report. when he said, "If a thought may be interjected, it is hoped that these volumes will prove of help to those who suffered, as well as to those who want to prevent a recurrence of such suffering, and that it shall never again in the future be necessary to record such history." And that is why I share my father's story for the same reason with you today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And I think, not to argue with the captain, we do have time for some questions. Yeah. I'm not sure how much time, so if someone will tell me when it's one more. Yes, ma'am. What happened to my father's brother? If I had more time, I could talk for 10 hours. So I went back into the records and I found a list of Jews from the town of Tichen who survived, and indeed, my father's brother, Monik Zaltzman, was on it. We did a whole worldwide search with the Red Cross, with the International Tracing Service. We wrote to Australia and Shanghai. And I went back to the USC Shoah Foundation tapes and found someone who said that he and his brothers had been with my uncle in the forest, Monik Zaltzman. He lived in Chicago, this man. And he told me that they were in the resistance together, fighting the Nazis. And after the war, they went back to a house in Poland. Poland was dangerous after the war. There was, you know, no American forces, no British, no French. And there was still a lot of anti-Semitism and violence. And so they went back to a house where the sister had left a baby to be hidden. And through a window, they didn't want to give the baby back. Someone had a gun, and my uncle was shot and killed. And left to die that day. But I found the brothers, and not only that, I found the little girl who took my uncle's name as her own and understood that he died trying to retrieve her. And she lives in Chicago too. Any other questions, comments? Yes.
I've watched several documentaries on the recovery of Jewish treasures and art. Have you participated in any of that, or what's been your success rate if you have recovering family heirlooms?
I mean, the question was, what have we recovered? I mean, nothing. You know, we went back and we were told we were the first Jews to come back to the town. I remember when I went into my father's home and I just had this dream that I would go into the attic and find something. And I did. I went into the attic. It was when you opened the door, you didn't have to climb a ladder, and there was nothing in there, just empty shelves. Everything during the war had been sold or taken or bartered. And then, you know, afterwards the communists came in, the records were destroyed in the town halls and municipalities. So there was nothing. We did not try and take the property. I think my grandfather had signed it away. I mean, there was no choices. Jews weren't allowed to own property. So, you know, we had no heirlooms. I'm just lucky, you know, to have my father.
Any other questions?
Yes.
How long did your dad, did he hesitate to tell you the story? I think you mentioned that. How long did it take to convince him to open up
the bank? I mean, my father, you know, didn't want to talk about it like a lot of Holocaust survivors and like a lot of American liberators. I mean, I've met with a lot of families of American soldiers, and they also, when they came back, were told, you know, start a new life, the baby boom began, put it behind you. But it was very, all of them who wrote about it. One of my father's highlights of his life was meeting General Gavin at the Pentagon and saying, you know, I am one of those skinny prisoners in the stripes that your soldiers liberated. But a few have written books. And it's even now still that, you know, they're painful, difficult memories. And I think people didn't want to ask because they felt that it was painful and they didn't want to upset them. So it wasn't really until I was probably in my 30s, I was already married and had a family of my own, that I confronted my father. And initially my family was, you know, concerned that, you know, he had repressed this and what was I doing and why. But not only was it life-changing for myself, for my father too.
Because when we travel to places like Austin Peay State University, and there's a huge army base there, and soldiers would come up and thank him, and my father would thank them, he went from being a victim to a survivor. And so I think now when we see, you know, the rise in anti-Semitism, and not just the old anti-Semitism, you know, of centuries ago, but the anti-Semitism where people are parading around dressed up like Nazis, honoring the Nazi flag without understanding the dishonor of the American flag by doing that, it becomes more important because the history is being denied and distorted. And so we have to really teach the next generations. And that's why we have the books and the films. We're speaking at military bases, corporations, churches, rotaries, going into school districts, working with Holocaust commissions in Texas and Tennessee, in North Carolina, because there are very few survivors and very few children of survivors who you know, got the story and did what my son is doing now with the next generation, taking it upon himself to make sure that we are teaching this in a truthful way. Yes, ma'am, and then, yes.
You mentioned that your mother was also in the concentration camp. Did she share her stories with you, or what was?
So my mother was in hiding for a while. She was blonde, and she would tell people her parents were dead. She was Polish. She worked as a maid. You know, like many hidden Jewish children, she learned to pray the Christian Catholic prayers so that she could hide. She eventually, with her family, crossed into Russia, where they were sent to a labor camp in Siberia. And after the war, she came back. She was in a town called Chechen. And as I said, there was great violence, and the Jews were fleeing. And so she joined an organization called the Bricha, which means to escape. And she had the job of going and searching for and finding the Jewish hidden children to try and reunite them with a family. So she didn't talk about it, but just, you know, 2 years ago, I discovered 16 photographs she gave to the U.S. Holocaust Museum of her with these children in the woods. And so now she is recognized as someone who did this important work.
Last question.
Yes.
I just want to say thank you so much for what you're doing. And it's fantastic. If I didn't run a marketing firm, I'd be a history author of some kind.
Well, you can do both. You can be a history author.
I tried.
We need all the history authors that we can. But thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it. We have been to many rotaries, and I have the highest regard for the organizations, the work that you do, the caliber of people. And if I live in Fort Worth, you're going to say you don't have to live in Fort Worth to join, but you have to get in line behind Irving and HEB and Las Colinas and Southlake and Grapevine. And thank you so much.
Thank you very much. That was a wonderful talk, and I wholeheartedly agree. We have to continue to share what has happened to avoid repeating the same mistakes. And we are seeing a rise in anti-Semitism and a lot of hate groups, and it just pains me that, okay, hey, look, you know what our grandparents did to, I mean, the Americans did to liberate the world from this scourge, and it's like, please don't let us go back there again. So thank you for what you're doing in that. As we talked about earlier, the whole Rotary world is in this fight to end polio. So in honor of your presentation today, our club is making a donation to the Polio Plus Fund, and this is a memento of that.
Thank you so much. That
thank
really
you
means a lot.
Very much. Closing announcements. This we have an international committee meeting in the Imperial Room on the 12th floor today. We have, what does that say? Community something due. What? Grants. Community grants. Thank you, whoever wrote that. Community grants are due on October 15th. Those of you with organizations looking to receive a grant from our endowment, please get those in. Next week on October 13th, we have Dr. Cheryl Harding, PhD, LNFA, President and CEO of the James L. West Alzheimer's Care Center. Thank you very much for your attendance. I hope everyone has a great weekend. And with that, this meeting is adjourned. Yeah.